Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private. Item 3 will be an opportunity for members to consider the committee's approach to further consideration around understanding barriers to local elected office. Item 4 is a chance for the committee to consider its approach to the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill. Item 5 will be a chance for the committee to agree its approach on new standards of fire alarms in all homes in Scotland. And item 6 will be an opportunity for the committee to agree its approach to scrutiny of the Building Safety Bill legislative consent memorandum. Do members agree to take items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private? And if anyone online doesn't agree, you can make that, put an N in the chat.
Agreed.
Thank you. So that's everyone agreed. Okay. The second item on our agenda today is taking evidence on the draft of the fourth National Planning Framework, or NPF4. This is the fourth of five evidence sessions the committee will be holding on NPF4. The focus of today's session is on local government issues. On the 22nd of February, we'll hear from the Minister, and I would like to welcome Councillor Stephen Heddle, Environment and Economy Spokesperson. Callum Lindsay, Policy Manager for the Environment and Economy at COSLA. David Dune, Interim Chief Officer of Strategic Place Planning from Aberdeen City Council. Craig Isles, Service Lead, Planning and Building Standards from South Ayrshire Council. Pam Ewan, who's the Head of Planning at Fife Council and also is the Chair of the Heads of Planning Scotland. Sarah Shaw, Head of Planning Neighbourhoods, Regeneration and Sustainability at Glasgow City Council. Ian McDermott, who is the Executive Manager of Planning from Shetland Islands Council. And Jane Tennant, who is the Chair of the Royal Town Planning Institute, Scottish Young Planners Network. Thank you all for joining us today, and we're going to move straight to questions, and witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please add an R in the chat box to indicate this. I just want to also say that there's quite a few of you, which is really fantastic. What we tend to do is direct our questions to one or two people initially, and if you feel that there's really something really important related to that question that you want to highlight or bring into the conversation, then please do join in. But if something's already been said, just because of time, we've got 90 minutes on this, then, you know, can move on to the next things. And I may have to at some point also cut you off. So please, I hope that's okay. So the first question I have is that we've had concerns repeatedly raised by witnesses around the vagueness of language within the draft NPF4. And I'm keen to hear if you share those views, and specifically what language needs to be improved or revisited to ensure NPF4 delivers positive concrete outcomes for our local communities. And I'd like to start with Pam Ewan, because of your responses already in writing, and then maybe I'll go to Jane Tennant and Sarah Shaw. So, Pam.
Morning, convener. Yes, I'm at Heads of Planning Scotland as the representative organisation for senior planning officers from Scotland's planning authorities, often referred to as HOPS. And this, as you mentioned, was one of the clear challenges with the draft that we set out in our interim response. And we've raised concerns about the fragility of the draft policies as currently the must. And it echoes subtle, often subtle differences in wording, but it's absolutely critical to how NPF4 is going to be delivered. And, you know, one of the things that we've raised is if government considers that to address climate change needs a real step change in how our places are developed, how they grow, then NPF must require such policy change, really with no ambiguity. We have to remember that we're debating a draft, and it's rare, if ever, that a draft is produced of such a complex document and it gets it right first time. That's the whole point of this debate and the engagement that is ongoing. But the policy wording is too loose and it's too imprecise, and it won't stand up to rigorous and forensic legal challenges. And it will really weaken the opportunity to drive change through the policy intentions, which are evident in the draft MPF4. But collectively, HOPS believes we need to strengthen confidence in the planning system and make sure that those policies are robust. We don't end up at lots of appeals and legal challenges. And we note that both Solar and the Law Society support those aspects as well. Lastly, there are lots of words. I won't go through them all, but there's lots of words that need defined. What's good green jobs? What's high quality? What is great places? And there's lots of people who have given evidence that they've done in that. Heads of Planning will be very happy to continue to work with government to help work through some of those finer points.
Thank you very much for that. And that was really helpful to get some specific examples like good green jobs. Yes, indeed. What does that actually mean? Can I bring Jane Tennant in?
Thanks, convener. I'm Jane Tennant. I'm the chair of the Scottish Young Planners Network. The young planners are those who are in the first 10 years of their career post-qualification. And it will be for us to take this plan forward into towards the end of its timescale. I would echo much of Pam's points with regards to ambiguity and challenges, like legal challenges over wording, particularly in terms of wording such as significant or unacceptable. What is meant by significant or unacceptable? I think some thresholds require to be built into that, particularly where you talk about the carbon, lifetime carbon, like a threshold is required, maybe like a framework of what's required over the next 5 years, and then sort of 5 to 10 years, what are we looking at in terms of that being significant? And also things like community wealth building, whilst we can read the theory and understand it, there's a couple of problems in potentially the subjective application of these objectives and the further legal challenge off the back of that. So we do need to make sure there's criteria and thresholds built in.
Thank you very much for that. And once again, really grateful for your specifics on that. And just lastly, Sarah Shaw, on this, if you want to come in.
Hi, yes, thanks. Sarah Shaw, Head of Planning in Glasgow City Council. I think, again, echoing what the previous two speakers have said, I think there's particularly some of the newer policies in NPF4 particularly require some clarification and clearer wording. As Jane has mentioned, the climate crisis, the policies which have been introduced on that, where it talks about significant emissions and, you know, acceptable impacts, that's extremely vague. And as these are new policies and these are new policy areas which planners are going to have to apply, we need particular clarity on that. I would also say some of the policies relating to the nature crisis and natural places, there's quite a number of areas where it talks about protecting and identifying networks and again, acceptable impacts, net biodiversity, net gain, but there isn't really any guidance on that. And we would have welcomed some overt linking of the Nature Scotland guidance, which is coming through, to give that status. Otherwise, every council will be applying these in an individual way and there will be inconsistency across the board. But generally, some of the policies are quite precise, but there are certain areas which do need firming up. And we'll obviously be making a more detailed response to those particular areas.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And you raise another issue that's been brought up to us, which is the whole piece around linking this framework to the other existing policies. I think Graham Day would like to come in with a supplementary.
Thank you, Camille. Just to be absolutely clear and for the record, is the plea here that in every instance in the draft, the use of the word may in this context should be replaced by shall or must, or are witnesses suggesting there may be some areas in which retaining that vagueness would be welcome?
Anybody in particular you want for that?
Probably people who are
in. Okay. So if we can bring back in Pam on that.
Yes, convener. Unfortunately, I don't think it's as straightforward as that. What we need to do within MPF4 is really look at what are the fundamental policies that we're really saying as a country. We really need to deliver these. There's no ambiguity. And if that's when government decides those are those policies, I've used the example of addressing climate change, then that's where we don't want ambiguity. That is that we require them or they must deliver them. Where you have a should, you will have debate. Now, planning is subjective by its nature. And for each development that comes forward, for each local plan, when you look at it, then that's the essence of planning, weighing up different factors. But I think what Heads of Planning is saying is there are some policies in there that we would really expect to be require or must or language like that. It's difficult. It's not easy, because what we're really asking for is that balance of clarity and certainty, not just to planning authorities, not just to the planner that's sitting with the planning application in front of them, wanting clear and concise national policy and how to interpret it, but also for our communities and to grow further confidence in the planning system, for our investors across Scotland as well.
Thank you, Pam. And I think Stephen Hedley wants to come in on this as well.
Yeah, thanks very much. To respond directly to Mr. Day's question, the answer would be no. We don't believe it should be a blanket strengthening of every should to must. It needs to be a more nuanced approach than that. And by way of example, referring to Pam's initial comments about addressing the climate emergency, for policy 2, climate emergency, all developments should be designed to minimise emissions over its life cycle in line with the decarbonisation pathways set out nationally. Yes, that's one that where the could should be strengthened to a must, to give the local authorities a firmer position to tackle the global climate emergency. But the counter example would be something like policy 5, community wealth building. Now, we're massive supporters of community wealth building, but we feel that the should be remain there, because we support community wealth building, but not all areas are covered by it or have the ability to access it. So it would be a blunt instrument in that case. And indeed, the upcoming community wealth building bill means that the relationship between planning and community wealth building will need to be carefully considered and explored there. So what position would be to support the Scottish Government in the review of the wording of the Scottish planning policy to identify the cases where it does need strengthening? And I think that's consistent with the position advanced by HOPS. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that very specific, very good to have those examples. I'd like to, I'm going to move on with another question, but Stephen, I'm going to direct it initially to you. And this is around the kind of consultation timescale. So there's been quite a bit of concern around the fact that, you know, we're consulting at the same time as the government and gathering the feedback from stakeholders. And so in light of this, I'd like to ask you to expand on these concerns and the feedback on how you would like consultation to take place as a final plan is developed.
I have to be honest and say I don't have a clear answer to that. I mean, we're finding in our own sphere the I suppose pressures in responding to the consultation currently ongoing on the framework. So far we've only provided a holding response, and we're developing the more nuanced response through our committee structures. Indeed, we'll be addressing that this Friday at the Environment Economy Board, and subsequently at the Coastal Leaders before the end of March, when we need to respond. I suppose the question that's maybe inherent in this is around the MPF4 as it develops, and whether there's a need to further consult on that. And I think my colleagues in HOPS and RTBI would probably have a more nuanced response to that.
Thanks, yes. And with that, Pam, you mentioned the fact that this is a draft stage and this is the consultation and it is a process. If you've got any further thoughts around the fact that there is this dual consultation, I appreciate hearing from you.
Thank you. I mean, HOPS considers that the consultation process today, it's been very collaborative. I think it's been appropriate and very proportionate. And there's been lots of opportunities throughout to participate even before the draft has come out. So there's been a lot of work and a lot of wide-scale engagement before that. You know, your pertinent question is, you know, should there be further consultation? And I think that really hinges around whether Parliament considers there should be a significant shift from any of the draft policy that's currently before us. And then further consultation, I think, heads of planning would consider would be reasonable. It's important to get the wording right. Heads of planning would rather, if there was an additional few months added to the process and getting it right now, rather than moving forward with like the previous conversation policies that may be ambiguous. And at the end of the day, it'll save more time, it'll save appeals, it'll save court cases, which only go to slow investment and absorb often unnecessary resources. So getting it right is important, and we've got that opportunity to do that now. And as I've expressed, Heads of Planning will be very happy to continue to work collaboratively with government on that.
Great, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to move on and bring in questions from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, Convener. And can I refer members to my register of interest? I'm a serving councillor on East Lothian Council. Just really to expand on the point that the Convener mentioned in the first couple of questions, and it's really just around about the different sections of the NPF4 National Spatial Strategies. And some of the comments we've had so far is that they don't carry through to national planning policies, and there seems to be a disconnect. So I suppose it's really just a question around about that. One, do you share that concern? And if so, I mean, are there any examples? But also, what would be the best way to try and make sure there is that connectivity? And Pam, will probably come to yourself first of all, if that's okay. And probably ask Sarah after that, but Pam, to yourself first of all.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, it's a lengthy document. It's a pretty complex document when you start to read it. And it is important to get that upfront part. I think there's the opportunity to make the upfront part of the document a bit more concise, a bit shorter, because the policies are the fundamental aspects of how that will help, for instance, determine planning applications across the country. So there are areas where it just needs to be pulled through in a bit more detail. And some of those read across of the documents isn't clear with specific priorities flowing through. An example that comes to mind is around the heat and energy. And how, you know, those early intentions, ambitions are coming out pretty strongly, and how does that flow through into the policy? A colleague previously talked about the nature crisis as well, how that can refer to Nature Scotland's documentation. So all of these cross-references to documents, because at the end of the day, from heads of planning perspective, if you're the case officer sitting with a planning application in front of you, you need that clarity, you need that precise, and it's down to the wording of what is in the document. But I also think some of the cartology needs to also be improved, some of the very schematic maps. And we need to look at, you know, how will that detail be taken through into local development plans and, where appropriate, regional spatial strategies. Some of those overlapping areas are actually quite confusing. You know, that there are some council areas in South Ayrshire, for instance, where it doesn't cover the one council area. So how do we get that clarity in moving it forward? The discussions we've had in Heads of Planning, it's really important to remember that those styles were appropriate for national planning frameworks up to now, but the fundamental changes, this will be part of the development plan, and this carries much, much more status. So that clarity and definition has to be built within that.
Pam, just on that before I'll probably bring Sarah in after that. In terms of the national planning policies, Does that need reviewed more broadly, or does it just reviewed almost piece by piece, I suppose, policy by policy, or does it need a much broader review in terms of that? You know, I know we've had the review planning just a couple of years ago, but the connectivity, as you said, is really important because it's what we're moving forward on to. So in your opinion, and I'll open it up to the panel as well, do we need a much broader review of that, or is it just almost policy by policy to make sure there is a connectivity right across the policy sphere?
I think it's policy by policy. You know, heads of planning consider that overall the scope of NPF4 is about right. We support the direction of travel and we support the ambitions, particularly related to climate emergency, nature crisis, net zero. But to achieve that, really, the key point we're making here has got to be clear, it's got to be concise, and it's got to be deliverable. The one aspect that we are disappointed in is that the draft delivery plan wasn't published alongside the draft NPF. So we're really debating a new part of the development plan in Scotland without the clarity on how it will be delivered. And a capital programme is fundamentally essential, as is revenue. So I do think it's about, I certainly don't want to give the impression that a lot of the policies are wrong. They're heading in the right direction. It's about tweaking it. It's about the nuances that we've talked about. And we're very happy to sit down and give support and give resource into helping shape those up into their final form.
Thank you for that. Can I bring Sarah in, if she's okay, and then open it up to the floor beyond that?
Yeah, just again to, I think Pam's mentioned this already, but the front end of the document is quite wordy and there are many, many layers. The spatial strategy elements are divided up, you know, into principles and also then the action areas. And I think we feel, again, as Pam has said, some of the action areas, the definitions are quite loose. The central urban transformation area, for example, covers a very, very wide range of different communities, different cities and smaller communities, and how that's kind of taken forward into the vision for those areas is taken forward into the policies isn't entirely clear. For example, you know, the elements of vacant and derelict land, some of that is the ambition that obviously is to reduce vacant and derelict land across Scotland. It's possible that there could have been more of an overt recognition that this potentially could have been a national development. Certainly within the Clyde mission, it's recognised as being part of one of the elements of the Clyde mission, but it's not particularly the delivery of how that will be achieved then doesn't necessarily come through the rest of the strategy, and it maybe could have been more overt. And I think generally it's quite wordy, that that front end of the document is quite difficult to kind of follow the logical flow through some of the ambitions, which I don't think any of us disagree with at all, but how that can be achieved through the policies. And I think there could have been a bit more clarity in that. And some of the parameters of some of the mapping, again, has been drawn quite narrowly. So, for example, the Clyde Mission is a very narrow corridor along the river. And if it's really to tackle vacant and derelict land in the west of Scotland, it would have been, it maybe needs to be widened out. The scope of that development, national development, could be widened out. There are other examples as well. But I think generally, you know, it is that front end that's probably more confusing in the way it reads, and maybe the thrust of that needs to be clarified.
Thanks, Sarah.
Thanks, Sarah. And Craig would like to come in on this.
Thank you, Chair. Just two points on that, just to reinforce that this document is actually a working document, it's not a strategy document, and it'll be a document that will be used to assess every single planning application that's determined in Scotland. I think that's where the precision of the policies is really important. It'll be from everything from a householder to a wind farm, and we need to make sure that that's absolutely correct from there. And that's where I think the policies require to probably to be split down more to reflect more some of those areas. From there, the very broad brush, I think, and that would be a concern in relation to that. Just in relation to the spatial matters, and being particularly selfish from a West of Scotland Ayrshire point of view, the central urban transformation area covers right through the central belt, but also lips down the coast towards some of our settlements down at Girvan and such like, and puts them into the same category as Glasgow and Edinburgh. And the map also includes the Isle of Arran as well, which I think is probably, well, it's in North Ayrshire, probably doesn't relate to the same issues that Glasgow and Edinburgh and such like in the Central Belt have in themselves. So there's things like that that need clarity. And again, it's a working document. If we have applications in those particular areas, the boundary lines are unclear just as to where that zone is, particularly as it runs through the middle of our district. You know, it's impossible to tell where our settlements actually sit on those, on that line. When, if you're looking at the map on page 31, it is, members. It lips down the coast there, and that is unclear as to whether some of our settlements that sit slightly inland are in that zone or whether they're not in that zone. And that will be vital when it comes to assessing an application at the end of the day, which is what this document, as I say, is for. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Craig. And David also wants to come in on this.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I think to sort of echo the points that have been made previously, but I think the action zones and that spatial strategy are probably the part of the document that we would struggle with most. For example, if you take the northeast, the action zone identifies energy transition as being the sort of key aspect moving forward, but that seems at odds with. And this goes back to a point that Pam made about the read across all of Scottish Government's documents, but it's at odds with, for example, the City Region Deal or our own regional spatial strategy or our current strategic development plan in terms of understanding the importance of diversification and moving away, not just being solely focused on energy. And even the previous national planning framework was very clear that, you know, food and drink, particularly in the northeast, given the fishing industry and the agricultural industry, is particularly important. So I suppose I struggle a little bit to understand what the role of the action zones really is. And if you follow that on in terms of some of the actions that come out of that, like the reinvent and future-proof city centres, that would appear to be focused, as Sarah made the point earlier, very much on the Central Belt. But obviously Aberdeen, having a substantial city centre and a regional city centre, you know, we would have thought that that policy would apply. And that kind of feeds back into Craig's point about the importance of this document in terms of actually determining applications. So what policies apply, what policies don't apply. And I think that is something that we need to get we need to get right. That front section of the plan in that context, I think, as I think Sarah mentioned, could be streamlined a bit and could be sort of focused on a little bit more to ensure that it covers the right areas and excludes, as Craig has mentioned, the ones that aren't appropriate. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, David. And I'm going to bring in Ian. It's actually very good to hear these more specific issues around the action zones that feel like just kind of swaths of colour on a map of Scotland. And I'm actually curious, if we weren't going to do action zones, what would be a good way to map out different areas in Scotland? Ian, if you want to pick up on Paul's question.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. It's certainly an area that's been concerning us in Shetland. I've been speaking to Orkney and the Western Isles as well, and these action areas do cause a bit of concern. So widespread geographically in the north and west coastal innovation area. And although we have some things in common, even where we are in common, there's quite a degree of difference, I suppose. So there's things like transport links are, you know, very important, very extended transport links. There's a huge cost to getting off the islands. And even the problem of getting from our outer islands to our local services here in the mainland part of Shetland. And we have a lot of differences in terms of things like settlement patterns, which obviously impacts on land use planning policies and how we implement the national planning framework. Some areas we have population decline, but Orkney's population is increasing. Some of us have difficulty naturally recruiting to vacant posts. There's skill shortages across all sectors. In places like Shetland, we have 100% employment nearly. Although one thing I think we all have in common is difficulty to recruit to planning service jobs. I think we're all really struggling to see how the benefit, I suppose, of these action areas, how they tie in with the regional spatial strategies and the links into the local development plan. And to give you an example, you know, Orkney and Western Isles could possibly fit more comfortably into the northeast transition area, where we're looking at actively planning a just transition from oil and gas to a net zero future. So we're thinking about the future of Sullom Voe here in Shetland, or Scapa Flow in Orkney, then it really maybe ties more into the what's the National Planning Framework is trying to achieve in the northeast of the Aberdeen area. So I think although the action areas look very good and they sound good, I do worry they create a lack of certainty when we get down to local development plan level, local authority level. And as has been highlighted before, could make development management decisions particularly difficult. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And Paul, you want to come back in?
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of that, it probably leads us quite nicely into the next two questions that I've got. And you kind of just touched on that. One is, do local authority planning departments have sufficient, suitably qualified staff and funding to deliver the desired NPF4 outcomes? And I think I know what the answer is going to be from this. And I can see the wry smiles already on this, so there'll probably be a few people to answer this. And also, how can we then best attract people into the profession in the coming years? And I'll probably go to Jane first of all, and then open it up probably to Stephen, and then open it up to the floor as that. But Jane, probably yourself as well, obviously just been in the industry a certain period of time, so I'll open it up.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I would echo much of Robbie Calvert's points that he raised in the second session, and that the RTPI have estimated some costs in terms of taking this forward. So they estimate that to undertake its, the core statutory functions of the planning system is going to require about £68 million over the next parliamentary term. And whilst this essential resource can be met with an increase of fees, there's still £24 million that needs to be funded from the Scottish budget over this next parliamentary term. This equates to approximately 40% net revenue increase for the planning system over the next 5 years. But in terms of budgetary asks for the annual increase of local government block grants, it would equate to just 0.01% of the total Scottish budget. We do have additional duties. We've got regional spatial strategies, local place plans, and a costing for that that the RTPI estimates about £3.7 million, and that's for the parliamentary term. And further, in terms of actually getting people into the industry, whilst the RTPI does a lot of work and the Scottish Young Planners Network goes out to universities, planning schools, etc., we do need to do a wee bit more work in that. But there's also the Chartered Town Planner Apprenticeship Scheme, which the RTPI estimate would cost about £10.4 million over the next parliamentary term. And it's in this point I would like to develop a little bit more, because a recent study showed that only around 9% of local authority staff are under 30 years old, which means we're kind of top heavy as a profession. And the replacement demand for that is particularly high, given the number of members that we have here in Scotland, which is around about 2,100. And we're looking at sort of need to replace sort of 500, 600 planners over the next sort of 15 years, which is ultimately like in a quarter of what we have. And young planners want to deliver on the ambitions of the NPF4. We think that the ambitions are there, and largely a lot of the work needs to be done in terms of climate emergency, etc. However, we do need a well-resourced system, and we also need clarity in the NPF in order they are our tools in order to deliver this.
That's great to get it down to numbers. Very, very helpful. Stephen Heddle wants to come in, and also Pam Ewan.
Yeah, thanks very much. It's a very pertinent question, and I'm very pleased that the RTPI have led on this in providing research around the current state of the planning system workforce. For the local government point of view, the resourciness, the kind of the practically the existential question, because in the last settlement we were of course delivered a £378 million real terms cut, which has been ameliorated by a £120 million adjustment recently, which means that we're just a quarter of £1 billion down, or £50 per person in Scotland. So in local government in general is suffering a resourcing crisis. And the planning system in particular is suffering a resourcing crisis, both in terms of the ability to deliver the service, and this is why we advocate moving quickly to full cost recovery in order to do that, but also to develop the service, because we have a recruitment problem in that we need to recruit over the next 10 to 15 years of the order 700 new entrants into the sector. And they don't get trained overnight. This is a number of years to become a skilled planner. And also because of the impact of NPF4 in refocusing priorities towards a just transition to net zero, we're going to require to reskill the workforce in general. So, yeah, absolutely, the resource implications of this process must be considered as part of the impact of the framework. The full cost recovery is, you know, it's part of the solution, but it's not necessarily the solution. We need to understand in a more holistic form how the planning service has to be resourced, and indeed this is something that's a major topic regularly at the high-level group on planning performance, which I co-chair with the Minister and our colleagues in HOPS and RTBI are represented.
Thank you, Stephen. And Pam, and then Craig.
Thank you. A very pertinent point indeed in terms of resources, and are we resourced to deliver the intentions and aspirations of NPF? We have a proposed application fee or statutory fee coming forward, as HOPS understands, and that will very much be welcomed by HOPS. However, this is likely to fall very much short of full cost recovery that has been sought by heads of planning for over a decade now. And that's compounded by the reduction of a third of planning staff since 2019, and over the same period in real terms, a budget reduction of 43%. And with a demand that, you know, Jane and Councillor Herrill have talked about of 400 planners forecast needed into the sector in the medium term, it's really difficult to imagine how the planning system and planning authorities can deliver the government's NPF4 aspirations without full cost recovery and proper resourcing. And there's perhaps never been a more exciting time to be a planner and working in the planning system. But the flip side of that is there's never been a more important time to get that proper resourcing in place. When we look at the draft, we've talked about some of the complexities this morning of the draft NPF. And when you look at those complexities, that requires additional work for planning authorities. It requires additional work for promoters of sites as well. You know, it's not just planning authorities or planners working in local government. And that's on top of the 49 new and unfunded duties that came to planning authorities through the 2019 Act. So, you know, on the ground, in the front seat of planning and local authorities and others working across the system, we need to be able to resource that work. And we also need to be able to upskill in terms of the talent we've got and the skill set that we have. I would like to just bring in that this is a fundamental issue for heads of planning. And we've been having the discussion, there's two aspects. There's the money side, and we've been having the discussions with the Minister on that. And there is also the people side, this gap as a profession, and your question related to both. I'm pleased to say that heads of planning very recently commenced a study on future planners with the Royal Town Planning Institute and supported by Scottish Government. And that's looking at recruitment, it's looking at retention, and it's looking at the promotion of planning as a career in planning authorities. And those are the challenges that need to be addressed, but there's opportunities that need to be created as well. So, as Chair of HOPS, I really can't stress enough the critical need to properly resource planning authorities. And that's now. It's not in 3-7 years' time, or wait another decade. The planning fees that are proposed to come forward is actually addressing a backlog of resourcing issues. And what we want to look forward to is how do we help implement MPF4 as the government intends to do.
Thank you, Pam. It's good to hear you say that it is an exciting time. I think that's absolutely true to come into planning, and I would encourage many young people because it is such a critical role. Craig would like to come in.
Just, I suppose, drilling it down to a more practical level of what we are required to do. One of the driving forces of the changes to the planning system is about getting the community involved in it. There's been touched on earlier there, the local place plans. Now, the local place plans are to be done by the local communities with assistance of the planning authority, is the way that's been shaped up. So in South Ayrshire, we have 29 community councils. So each of them could bring forward a local place plan with the expectation that the planning authority would be able to help them in bringing that plan forward. And we would need to incorporate that plan into our own ongoing workload of our own for our own local development plan, which would come in, we'd be looking to prepare at the same time following the NPF4 coming through. So just on a simple basis, at the moment we're preparing our policy sessions are set up to prepare a local development plan. This is an additional task where we potentially, I'm not saying no would, but potentially could have the supporting sort of 29 communities and of varying degrees of abilities and expertise and resource in the preparations of their own plans. But that is really where we would want to do that as much as we could. The communities are a hugely important part of the whole process. But that needs to be resourced. That's about bodies on the ground and actually supporting from there. And that's the sharp end, if you like, of the big statements about resources and bodies that are required. It's for tasks like that, which are completely new tasks to the system from there. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Craig. That was great. You actually have answered some questions I've been wondering about. You know, that level of detail is very helpful, and I know how much it takes because I've been involved in my own community's, not local place plan, but a kind of local planning initiative. I'm going to move on and bring in Graham Day with questions.
Thank you, Kabir. I think this is specifically in the first instance addressed to Pam Ewan. Hobbs, in written evidence, had suggested that to deliver on the ambitions of MPF4, it would require a significant culture change. I wonder if Pam Ewan could expand on that and perhaps touch on whether she thinks a culture change might extend to perhaps the attitude of councils towards planning. Because I think there was a reference a few moments ago to budgets having been cut by 43%. Well, such a budget cut would be well in excess of any budget change in the settlement between the Scottish Government and councils. So I'm wondering if there needs to be an attitudinal change as well within councils towards the significance of planning as a service.
Thank you. Thank you for your question. I think we've talked about culture change across the planning system for many years, and indeed that a lot of that change has come through. What I think is fundamentally important to this is the role of planning, the role of the planning service in police leadership, in involving and collaborating and working really closely with communities to help them have a bigger say than they've ever had about how their places should change, and Craig touched on the local place plans. So there is that culture change to do that, but there also needs to be a culture change in respect of how does any player involved in delivering the ambitions and the intentions of the National Planning Framework actually raise their game, change how they design a place, how they engage with the community, and how they bring that forward to the local authority? So I don't think this is just about local planning authorities or indeed councils. I think it's about all the players that are involved in delivering great places across Scotland. And we shouldn't forget that we already deliver really good quality places across Scotland. There's lots and lots of development coming forward all the time that's creating really good quality places. But for HOPS, what this MPF is really saying is let's make a step change in some areas. Let's go up a few gears. I've touched earlier on climate and addressing climate change, whether that's an absolute must, that must happen. So I think there are a lot of things there about the culture of change, and I've touched before about the skill set and the need to skill up, upskill across many that are working within the planning system, because it's not just planners. We will have lots of people in a council that are involved in the planning system, whether that's education, transportation, waste, health, environmental health. You know, across a whole of these areas, we'll have colleagues within our councils working towards that.
Thanks, Pam. And Stephen Heddle would like to come in as well.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Day, for that question, and good to see you again. You are suggesting that the planning services received a disproportionate cut, but doesn't match with any cut that might have been directed towards local government. But I mean, I should note that this 42% figure is since 2009, so it's over more than a decade. And it also reflects the amplifying effect that the directed spend, or the direction of spend, from Scottish Government has on the services where local government still has a degree of discretion. I mean, local government cuts any service with a heavy heart, and we would like to fund every service fully, and we'd like to develop every service to provide better services for our population. But the reality of the situation is that between 60% and 70% of all local government spend is directed by the Scottish Government. That leaves us very little discretion regarding the remaining 30% to 40%. And of course, regrettably, these services are the services that you're going to see experiencing the brunt of the cuts. And I always say, if anybody wants to know the effect of cutting the funding for local government, look at the state of your roads, because that's a discretionary service. And that's one of the areas where we regrettably have to cut the spend, and absolutely where we don't want to cut the spend. No, this is it's not a kind of matter of culture change. It's a matter of a change in attitude towards local government and the funding local government to allow us to adequately fund our services. And this especially in the time when we're trying to deliver a complete transformation of the world that we live in and moving towards net zero. The idea that we can achieve this transformation while receiving a £250 million cut to local government is optimistic, to say the least, and we really need to get real as far as the funding local government is concerned if we want to be able to deliver the step changes that we all want and we all have to achieve.
Thanks, Mr. Heddle. You want to come in with more? No, okay. I'm going to move on now and bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us on Blue Jeans. Mark, would you like to come in with your question?
Yeah, thanks, Camilla. Good morning. Quite a few of the witnesses have touched on the ambitious nature of the MPF4 draft. I was just wondering what people's views were on whether that needs to be accompanied by a capital investment plan to realise those ambitions, and perhaps come to Pam first.
Thank you. Absolutely. I've touched on already that Heads of Planning were disappointed that there wasn't a draft delivery plan published alongside the draft MPF4 to really allow us to have that thorough debate. And we understand that Scottish Futures Trust is taking forward that work, and we've reached out to them to work collaboratively with them to look at that in detail. But it has to be delivered. Infrastructure first is one of the things that comes through the draft document. And TIMIA's delivery of infrastructure is really fundamental if we're going to deliver the strategy. A funding mechanism that provides upfront infrastructure is needed, whether that's new school capacity, local energy systems, green networks, walking, cycling, waste, whatever it is. And in particular, in areas of lower land values. So the MPF has much more of a focus, much more of a direction in terms of the redevelopment within our town centres and brownfield sites. But where those sites aren't viable commercially to bring forward, then where is the capital programme that allows public sector to come in and intervene so those sites are delivered for the benefit of those communities? And it's important that a capital programme looks across other plans and strategies. I mean, in effect, MPF4 should be the spatial expression of Scottish Government policy and direction, and should be very clearly linked to other plans and strategies, some of which will need to be updated because they're not quite aligning with this. So the capital programme is absolutely essential. I would also just raise, though, it's not just about capital. It's also about, you know, understanding what the revenue — I'll use the word consequences lightly — but the revenue consequences of new development and growth and the pressure that puts on local councils. So it's actually understanding both the capital and revenue implications of the MPF4 and setting out clearly how that is going to be driven forward. And I think there are good examples. There's good examples in England just now. There's a lot of debate in England that's really paralleling this. But beside that, they're driving forward a capital programme. And as I understand, similar work has been done in Ireland. So we would very much call we've got to understand how this plan can be delivered. I always say writing a policy document probably doesn't feel like this, the chief planner, but writing a policy document is the easy bit. Actually delivering it is the hard bit, and the capital is essential to that.
Thanks, Pam. And I see that Craig and David also want to come in on this question around capital investment plans.
Thank you, Chair. In answer to the question, I think it's really important in Ayrshire, not just South Ayrshire, but all of Ayrshire, we have infrastructure problems with the transport network in terms of the roads, and that really needs investment to be able to take that forward. However, it's not mentioned in MPF4, and it's also not mentioned in another consultation document, which is ongoing at the moment, the Strategic Transport Project 2. And as you'll be aware, for funding to be brought through for these matters, they need to have a policy basis for them to be justified at that stage when they're coming through. So there isn't that connection between the real issues on the ground, perhaps in the wider areas outside the central belt, from the document, which needs to be reflected in it. And that's where it comes back to. There's an absolute must for that capital investment plan to help drive the projects and the plan forward. That infrastructure first is an appropriate way to go forward. However, the developers, the house builders, don't have the finance behind them to be able to fund those things up front. They require investment from central and local government to be able to take that forward to do those works, to take it on. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. And David.
Thank you, Convener. So I suppose just to pick up on two points, I would echo Craig's point on STPR2, and I think the importance of weaving that, as with other strategies that we mentioned earlier, through the document to give it this sort of policy support in terms of as applications come forward for those developments. But I think, just going back to the earlier point about infrastructure in relation, for example, to brownfield development, historically, Aberdeen has got a very limited supply of brownfield in comparison to other areas of Scotland. And our land values have historically been much higher, albeit I would say in recent years that has probably changed. But we've had to put a number of initiatives in place to encourage the development of both brownfield and, I suppose, the other challenge that we would have being some of our historic buildings, which are difficult to get back into use, but particularly in the city centre, we've tried to encourage their reuse for residential, again, reflecting some of the direction of the new MPF. But to give some examples, we have a 25% affordable housing requirement right across our administrative area, but we have waived that requirement for development within the city centre to try and encourage and support developers who want to use those buildings or those sites. And then on top of that, we've looked at the development viability on a case-by-case basis and waived other developer obligations where required. But I think the important point, and it goes back to the sort of infrastructure delivery, is that fundamentally those costs don't disappear. You know, the costs from those for those schools, for that other infrastructure, it doesn't disappear. It just falls on the public purse to pick it up, at local government in the first instance. So I think, as Pam mentioned earlier, I think a delivery plan to actually look at this, the proposals and the policies within MPF4, and actually allow Parliament to make a considered decision on those policies in terms of what the likely implication is at a local and national level in terms of funding. So I would echo the point that I think the delivery plan is vital, but I think we also need to look at some of the policies in the round as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, David. I'm going to move on and bring in Megan Gallagher with her question. So, Megan.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Before I ask any question this morning, I would like to refer members to my register of interest, as I am still a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. I would like to touch on 20-minute neighbourhoods this morning, as they are a significant feature and they run throughout all sections of the MPF4 document. So I'd like to ask the panel, how do you think 20-minute neighbourhoods can be delivered in practice, and particularly in relation to rural areas, as I know that a couple of contributions from you have indicated that this might be quite problematic. And if I could start with Craig, please, and then Pam. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. I think 20-minute neighbourhoods are basically good planning. I think that's what it's about. It's about bringing forward the appropriate development in the right location. And I think, for me, the brownfield developments are vital for us to be able to, if we can get them brought forward, that will, by the very nature of them, they are probably located in within a settlement and within a reasonable distance from other facilities, because they've probably been a factory or whatever in the past. So it's, for me, it's about bringing those elements back into it. But essentially, it's about good planning. It's about that linkages of the transport is a vital thing. We haven't quite touched on that this morning, but the sustainable transport is a huge factor in being able to make the good neighbourhoods work from there. And I think the essence of, I think all planners who have probably read the 20-minute neighbourhood idea, I thought, yeah, that's just good planning. And I'd like to, I'd probably stop at that before I ramble on to other things. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks. And then Pam, and also it would be great to hear from Ian on this from, you know, a Shetland perspective as well. Pam.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, just building on what Craig talked over, I mean, 20-minute neighbourhoods is not a new concept. As a planner, we have been working on that for a long number of years, and it is good planning. The challenge comes, and this is really what's at the essence of your question, the challenge comes on, you can't just apply that across Scotland. I think what has been sought to try and be achieved through the draft MPF is writing it in such a way that it is flexible to apply at the local level, because all our places are different. So the concept and the theory of 20-minute neighbourhoods is laudable and has been in planning practice for a long, long time. The challenge comes in the difficulty to deliver. And sometimes that's about the reality of whether it's delivering a shop in a community that doesn't have one. Well, that actually gets to the heart of behavioural change as society and the way we lead our lives. And it's a chicken and egg. If we don't create the places that encourage people to walk more, to shop more local and to live local, which is a theme that's coming through NPF, then how do we start to really fundamentally address those changes? But in some areas that might come back to, that requires public investment, public incentives to make those the components, or some of the components of a 20-minute neighbourhood actually deliverable. So the theory and the concept, wholeheartedly, heads of planning support it. But I think we need to really work through How do you deliver that in rural areas? And also, how do you retrofit it? I think often these discussions are about how do we apply MPF4 looking forward when new development proposals come to us, but that's only a very, very small part of Scotland's land use change, a very minor part of Scotland's land use change. So it's how do we retrofit, and what's the role for public sector in bolstering and creating 20-minute neighbourhoods?
Thanks, Pam. That's great that you're bringing in the whole retrofitting part, because that seems to get missed off on the conversation, and that's critical, I think, for our way forward. Ian, I don't know if you would like to come in with a Shetland perspective. That would be great.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, kind of the bane of our lives that the phrase 20-minute neighbourhoods came in. If I've had a pound for every time someone says it takes me 23 minutes to walk around, you know, it's like, no, it's not about the number of minutes, really. It's about the concept. But it's catchy, and it catches people's attention, and that's important too. I know discussing 20-minute neighbourhoods with my colleagues in the Western Isles and Orkney, they do have a concern about the relevance to rural and island communities. I kind of look back at the bit we were talking about earlier about the area action areas and the spatial strategy. And it does talk in there about island and coastal communities. We need a bespoke and flexible approach to the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods. For example, by identifying service hubs in key locations with good public transport links, point that Craig was making earlier on. And I think, you know, that flexible approach is something that we've been doing. You know, we need to adapt the 20-minute neighbourhoods to our particular circumstances. I also would echo the points that Pam and Craig make earlier, that planners have been doing this kind of thing for a long time. In Shetland, we've been working to these principles, but by their names, and our local development plan, as it exists at the moment, we have zones of preferred development, which aims to do a lot of what's in the 20-minute neighbourhood concept. We've got the NAB redevelopment site, which is actually mentioned in the MPF as well. And that's an on-the-ground example of why we're trying to implement these kind of policies about living locally. So I do think developing for communities and not commuters is applicable to every part of Scotland and not just an urban context. Thanks.
Thank you for that. It was good to hear that perspective. I'm going to move on to a topic, minimum all tenure housing land requirement. And I think I'll start with Pam and then bring in Sarah on this initially. So how do you think the minimum all tenure housing land requirement will work in practice? Is it clear enough? And will it direct new developments to where they are needed? And a supplementary that's kind of come up through evidence sessions is, do we need to be rethinking how we do housing in Scotland in general? So, Pam.
Thank you. I think firstly, Heads of Planning welcomes the concept of quality homes and supports the move to more flexible and locally based approach to the minimum all tenure housing land requirement. Housing land requirement is always a key debate, whether it be through national planning framework, structure, strategic plans of the past, and local development plans. But councils and local elected members know their area best, and this allows for local consideration as to whether and where those minimum targets should be increased. So through the local development plan process and working corporately across the council, councils will give detailed consideration as to whether those minimum targets should be increased to meet the needs within those areas. They may look at it from a policy approach perspective of, for instance, a particular town centre, or more flexibility around if there's particular elements of brownfield land they want to see coming forward. So Heads of Planning is comfortable with the approach that the Scottish Government have taken. They have involved planning authorities and who have worked closely with housing colleagues in councils on the approach that they have taken. do we support in principle the approach that's been taken in national planning framework? In terms of your question about, you know, does this approach of the minimum tenure direct housing to the areas? I mean, that needs to be looked at in the round, because that will, we have to look at what the other policies are of the national planning framework. I've mentioned brownfield, I've mentioned town centres, but there will be appropriate greenfield sites that will need to come forward as well, where those are sustainable. And it's about ensuring that there is the depth of choice of sites and quantity of sites that are deliverable and either have the necessary infrastructure available, or that there is a programme there to we've talked about infrastructure first, a programme there to bring that infrastructure forward. So we are comfortable as heads of planning with the approach that's set out in National Planning Framework 4, and we think that we can take that forward across all of our local development plans and gives that local flexibility to the elected members for making the decisions on those local development plans that actually know their local areas best.
Thanks very much. And Sarah, I don't know if you want to come in on that as well.
Thank you, yes. I think from a Glasgow perspective specifically, we felt there could have been an opportunity to be maybe potentially more overt about whether we want particular existing trends in terms of housing investment to continue within Scotland, or whether there was an opportunity to be more overt about trying to rebalance that. There's certainly a description about, you know, there's a prediction that the housing requirement in the west, in the east of Scotland, would be much stronger, and that's reflected in the housing land figures that's given in NPF 4. I think we felt that there could be an opportunity for this to be determined more locally at the city region level. Potentially there could be an opportunity to rebalance and to try and attract further housing, or to push further housing investment towards the west of Scotland, again picking up the vacant and derelict land and the capital investment that would be needed to do that. But this could be actually an ambition of NPF 4 to do that. And I think we feel that the potentially policy 9 to do with the housing land tenure requirements would be is potentially not, it's a very complex area, it's about a very dynamic area, and potentially that policy doesn't really convey that complexity. And there are certain elements as well that are possibly still could be defined more precisely. For example, whether the land requirement in NPF 4 means land for a certain number of houses or for a certain number of houses to be delivered. So there'll be a bit of debate about that, because again, this is the sort of thing that ends up in appeals and court cases. And potentially, again, there's some definitions within the policy which talk about short, medium and long term deliverable housing land pipelines. Again, there isn't a definition of that, and I think we will need some further clarification. So again, this doesn't end up getting scrutinised in courts and appeals, that we all know what we're talking about there.
Thanks very much for that. That's good to get the Glasgow West Coast perspective. I'm going to move on and bring in my colleague Willie Coffey, who's joining us virtually.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I want to develop a discussion a wee bit on how and whether NPF 4 deals with vacant derelict land that Sarah mentioned just a moment ago, but also derelict and abandoned and dirty, filthy shops that blight our high streets. We've got a lot of good work going on in a lot of town centres across Scotland, with communities and councils doing a lot of work to improve areas and towns that they can do. But many of my constituents often tell me, what can we possibly do about the extent of empty and abandoned shops that blight the high street that are principally, well, they're mainly privately owned. So my question, maybe to Sarah first and my Ayrshire colleague Craig Isles, is what can we do about this? Should NPF 4 strengthen those powers, or do you think that there are sufficient powers at the moment under the planning laws in terms of amenity notices to deal with issues like this? So I'd be obliged initially for Sarah and maybe Craig's response to that, please.
So a couple of aspects to this. Firstly, I suppose it's partly there's an aspiration in MPF 4, and I think across Scottish planning authorities to actually bring more residential uses into town centres. So there is a possibility there of repurposing some of these vacant sites. Again, that does depend rather on the market, and I think what you're talking about is more of a direct, can the council do something directly to influence this? In terms of enforcement, talking about immunity notices, one of the issues is that there is the councils do have powers of direct action to serve immunity notices in various situations, but the problem is they don't have a budget often to do that direct action, because then it has to be, the costs of that action have to be clawed back from the owner of the property, and that's not always very practical. So there are issues, practical issues there about the councils taking direct action. It's not necessarily so much about giving them legislative powers, it's partly about giving them the resources to do that. But I think also the whole concept of repurposing the town centres to make them much more multifunctional, less focused on purely retail, for example, will help, hopefully help, that there are practical issues, obviously, in converting shops to housing, and that's not always going to be possible, but that that kind of aim will certainly help towards it. There is a mention, I think, in the NPF4 about, you know, this idea of bringing city centre or town centre living to be more focused. And I think there was a policy saying that, you know, shop fronts or frontages, residential frontages, ought to be active, still active frontages. And I think that's really important in a town centre. Similarly, it's also important for retail and other uses in the town centre to have active frontages, and I think we need to make that clear as well.
Thanks, Sarah. And who's the other? Sorry, for Willie. Oh, Craig. Yeah, Craig. And then also Cal and Lindsay would like to come in on this, and then we'll move on.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, the Mr. Coffey raised a very pertinent point. There are certain challenges, and we all want to see, we know how our high streets are changing due to the COVID and the online shopping and such like, and how retailers are reducing their footprint in the high street. That does lead to the problem of how we then tackle that going forward. And purely from a point of view of the from an enforcement side, if you like, I think the amenity notices are limited in what they can do in terms of dealing with a shop front that may be dirty, vandalised, and perhaps because some, you know, you can see in and see all the mess of it inside. There's very limited you can do from an amenity point of view from the planning process to deal with that. The other side of it is when you move on to the more extreme situations of vacant and derelict buildings. And in South Ayrshire, we have a very prominent one in the Station Hotel. I'm sure the member will be aware of that. Where we have an absent landlord, he's not a British national, and it's a very difficult process to try and engage with that individual, and he doesn't wish to engage with the council in trying to resolve issues there. And we also have a dangerous building issue there, which is costing the council in terms of making that building safe for the public. Though, so when you follow that through, the process is there for the council to actually act on these things. You know, there's a notion that we could use our compulsory purchase powers. Well, to do something like that, we have to have a master plan to take it forward, which obviously is time and resource to be able to take that matter on. We also have to, as part of the legislation, you have to require to have the funding available to be able to carry out that master plan. Now, obviously, as has been discussed this morning, councils have limited resources in terms of these matters to take them forward. So that's where the real challenge comes in, and that's perhaps where funding comes from central government in relation to vacant and derelict land, should perhaps look at that, and there may be a need to look at the legislation in terms of the compulsory purchase powers. A number of these, and stepping away from the larger scale projects like that, the shop units and such like will be owned by investment companies who will have no interest at all in those high streets. They're merely a line on their balance sheets from there, and actually getting them to do anything with these buildings is very, very difficult. And the conversion of those buildings into other things, and it's probably because of the nature of how they've been built as a shop, makes it very difficult to change them into other things. So if we're reinventing the whole process here, I think the compulsory purchase process is something that really needs to be looked at, and investment put into that whole dealing with vacant buildings, vacant and derelict land. It feeds back into the previous question of 20-minute neighbourhoods. All the things that a 20-minute neighbourhood has are all in our town centres and in our local communities at the moment. You know, if you're doing up your brownfield sites and your vacant and derelict buildings, you're already fitting back into, retrofitting into those areas. And I think that's an area that should really be explored further. Thank you.
Thanks, Craig. That was really helpful. I'm going to bring in Callum, and then we'll move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. My R in the chat box was actually in relation to the previous point on minimum all tenure housing land requirements. If I could just very quickly flag the points, I know we're pressed for time. This is an example of where timing has been quite tricky, particularly for COSLA to form a firm position. It's an area that our members have flagged some concerns, mainly about the principle of target setting for local government. However, we've also seen today that HOPs are quite supportive of what's been put forward. Unfortunately, we've not been able to put that position of HOPs to our members to offer them the reassurance. And with different timing, we may have been able to present a firmer position. So just to flag that to you. On the members' question on vacant and derelict land, I would support everything that HOPs have said today. It can often be about resources, and usually as much about resources as legislative powers. Things like the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund have given us good examples of what can be done when the capital is there to address examples of vacant and derelict land. I think it's also an example of where stronger policies could, and strengthening the wording of some of the policies could be beneficial too, to go back to that point made at the very beginning. I think it's policy 30, which seeks to address this area, and we feel stronger wording there could give local authorities better tools in order to deliver the ambition of the framework. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And good to hear from you this morning. Sorry we haven't gotten you in sooner in the conversation. I'm going to bring in Miles for questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us this morning. And we've already touched upon infrastructure, and I wanted to ask specifically with regards to the draft, which MPF4, which states that we want an infrastructure first approach to be embedded in Scotland's planning system. So I wanted to ask the panel specifically what should an infrastructure first approach look like, and do you think the MPF4 in its current draft can help achieve that? So I'll maybe bring in Pam, and then if anyone else wants to comment on that, could you put an R in the chat? Thanks.
Thank you. Well, I've already expressed Heads of Planning view that we consider that infrastructure first approach is really essential. And actually, we've been talking about this for a long, long, long time. And we often look to mainland Europe to look at the examples there of really good examples. And of course, there are examples across our own country as well. But where it's particularly fundamental, and I think coming out through the discussions this morning, it's not necessarily about having the legislation or the statute in place. What's missing in a lot of this is where's the funding, where's the actual the capital resource and often the revenue resource in terms of having the people behind those projects. But where's those upping of those resources to deliver in our town centres, to bring forward those brownfield sites? And where you have large growth areas, I know that in my role as Head of Planning in Fife Council, but where you have these large growth areas, it's the funding streams to sometimes it's about a timing gap, you know, and it's about actually making sure a development that's coming forward is viable. And sometimes a new school needs to be delivered at a very early stage because of capacity issues or a particular piece of transport infrastructure. So it's really thinking through an early stage, an NPF. What is NPF saying? What's it directing? And where's the capital programme behind that that is going to deliver that infrastructure first programme? And what we've touched on today is it doesn't sit in isolation. It's the strategic transport policy review. It's about the economic review. It's about local heat and energy strategies. It's all of those bits of the jigsaw, as I often think about it. How do those all knit together to deliver a place in a timeous way and in a way which gives the best opportunity to create a quality place for our communities?
Thanks, Pam. Stephen would like to comment in as well.
Thank you very much. I think Pam's essentially made the point I was just about to make, that in understanding what would form an infrastructure, the first approach, we need to understand what are the infrastructure requirements and investments associated with the other plans and strategies that we wish the NPF4 to align to. And we have good alignment with some strategies, the kind of the drive towards net zero has been mentioned. But the specific example that Pam raised about the heat in buildings strategy, I mean, we believe that sort of decarbonising heat in buildings is going to cost approximately £4 billion, you know, to achieve that. I mean, that's clearly a fundamental part of our move towards the net zero, and understanding the infrastructure investment that's going to be associated with that, and dialing that into the NPF4 is, you know, just one example of the cut across to other strategies that we probably feel needs to be strengthened more. I mean, STPR2 has been mentioned. I mean, it gets mentioned 10 times throughout the document, the National Transport Strategy. It's mentioned 8 times throughout the document. So that's great. There's sort of kind of recognition of these strategies. But sort of heat in buildings gets no mention. And indeed, the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which we are eagerly awaiting at the end of this month, and it's going to be fundamental for direct and policy. It's not mentioned, and indeed the programme for government is going to be fundamental for this as well. So it's more a kind of question and an answer. It's how do we assure the adequate mapping of the strategies that's driving our investment and our public policy, and make sure that it's coherent with the NPF4.
Thanks, Stephen. And Craig would like to come in, but I just wonder, Miles, do you want to develop your question a little bit more?
Please. Thank you, Convener. I wanted to drill down a bit specifically into some of the competing pressures of competing strategic outcomes, and specifically, I suppose, to look at renewable energy. We know the targets which the country set itself for the production of renewable energy. So I just wondered, in terms of your council areas as well, whether or not you think NPF4, as it currently is drafted, will help deliver that renewable energy and some of the competing demands we know exist around, for example, restoration of peatlands. How will that be taken into consideration? It's quite a wide question, but I wanted to sort of look at, through the world of renewables, how NPF4 will meet those targets.
So Craig, I don't know if you want to come in and pick that up. If renewables is relevant to your part of the world in South Ayrshire, I think it is, and peatland probably too.
Yes, thank you. If I can, just at one point on the previous element there, I was just to mention that on the delivery of infrastructure, house developers don't have the funding, the finance behind them to pay for these things up front. They're required to pay for it on a sort of cash flow basis as we're selling our houses. So it's just that's why we need that sort of more central funding for the delivery of these matters. In terms of how it fits into renewables and does NPF4 do anything for renewables, I think South Ayrshire and East Ayrshire and the Dumfries and Galloway have all varied significantly in terms of land resource for renewable energies. And our areas are under significant pressure from those in the communities in those areas are tolerating a great deal in relation to the wind farms, which are getting larger and taller by the week, the applications that are coming in. I think there is, as far as I understand, infrastructure has been put in place for delivery of these matters. There certainly is enough areas for the wind farms to be brought through. And I know there's a huge amount of Scotland's renewable energy comes from that sort of southern Scotland area that covers those three authorities. I think there is opportunities through those wind farm applications for peatland restoration projects in and about the areas they're in. They tend to be in those localities where they do have peat areas which have been degraded over the years by the farming techniques and such like. And I think that's something that can be should be brought forward as a benefit for those schemes, and there should be some realm across funding for those wider areas for the address of the drainage issues and such like, which drain out those peats and make them less effective as carbon sinks. And I think that's, it's not, having been involved in it when I was in East Ayrshire, it's not that complicated. It just requires a wee bit of resource and taking it forward and agreement of landowners to take these things forward. So it's definitely deliverable there. And I think that's something that could be, that should be promoted. Thank you, Chair. Hopefully that answers the question.
Thank you, Craig. And I just wonder if anyone else, maybe Ian, would you like to come in on this renewable piece that Miles has asked about?
Yes, thank you. Yes, an interesting one is that we've got a very large wind farm being constructed at the moment in Shetland. A lot of local opposition to it, and one of the issues was the impact on peat. You know, does the carbon emissions from the peat that has removed outweigh the benefit of the wind farm in terms of renewable energy? And it's still raising issues on a daily basis here. I think the policy itself, as it's set in National Planning Framework, does give the right direction. And as always with planning, it's going to be about that balance. And I don't think you can actually say one development is definitely okay and one isn't based on this policy. It's when you get into the nitty-gritty of the environmental impact assessments, for example, that you know, we'll be able to focus in on whether the development is acceptable or not. I do think there are some parts of that policy that are maybe a bit too open-ended. For example, one of the bullet points in there is supporting a fragile population in a rural or island area. That's fairly open-ended, and I could see you could justify a whole range of developments on peatland areas using that bullet point alone. So possibly needs to be a bit of fine-tuning in there, but I think it's definitely pointing the development in the right direction and highlighting you know, the need to protect peatland carbon-rich soils and habitats. And as Craig said, a lot of it, and what I'm seeing at the Viking Energy development, is the quality of the restoration of the site is an important factor. And that's something that's, you know, assessed and developed through the planning conditions and monitoring of the development. Thanks.
Thank you, Ian. And I'm just going to come back to Miles for another question.
Thank you, Camille. Just finally, in terms of National Planning Framework being the opportunity to really ask and demand of all councils, really, that we meet these targets, do you feel it's going to help you achieve that, I suppose, is my key question? Because I think some of the more difficult and challenging points we'll see, for example, the production of larger size wind turbines is something many communities will come to yourselves with objections in, but meeting the targets which we've set out in terms of renewable energy is really being put to planning departments. So I suppose turning that question around is, do you then feel you'll have the tools to be able to help deliver that? And across Scotland, that's a national mission, which this is going to be tasking planning departments to achieve. And what would you like to see to make that process easier? We know that a lot of these applications end up being called in by the Scottish Government because of some of these challenges. So I just wondered where your views were, whether or not this planning framework has helped to make that easier or more difficult for yourselves.
I see Jane would like to come in on that question.
Thanks, Convener. It was more in relation to the last question, but also kind of in terms of the targets as well. I know there's been a lot of focus in the conversation thus far on wind, but I think from my environmental management background, I think it's primarily about a mix, and that's a mix of types and a mix of scales, decentralising a lot of our energy to like neighbourhood or district level through either heat and power and heat pumps, etc. There's a variety of ways that we can meet these targets, and I just, it's not all about wind, although that is one part of it, certainly.
Thank you, Jane. And Pam would like to come in on Miles's follow-up question.
Thank you. I think from my head's a planning perspective, we've also looked, there's a lot of consultations from government just now, all largely coming out at the same time. And one of the ones that we have looked at was around the wind strategy and the ambition of government. Perhaps national planning framework needs to provide a bit more evidence, I haven't seen it there, of what is the capacity of Scotland to accommodate that level of wind turbines that's been seen as the aspiration and the target set out. And there's been a lot of work done over the years looking at that. So, you know, it's really that what's the capacity of the country and what's the target? And actually what we don't know in planning authorities just now is, do the two equate? There has been a lot of work done over previous years looking at landscape capacity. And some areas of Scotland were saying, you know, they felt as if they were at capacity from a council's perspective and a planning authority's perspective. So I think there's a real dialogue here in terms of the way in which we want these developments to come forward. But, you know, touching on Jane's point, it's so much more than wind turbines, or certainly new wind farms, and should we put more into the kind of repowering of existing wind farms that are already consented and just need to be looked at in a different way. But energy storage and looking at a whole range of the local heat energy systems that's really coming through the NPF and also the related consultation and order that's been drafted on that. So all of these things are coming together, and what we need to understand is how does that relate to place at different scales, whether it's at a national level, a city region level, a local and a community level. So it's quite a complex area, but I do think the NPF could have more evidence behind it when you specifically talk about wind turbines and the capacity of the country to accommodate the ambitions that has been set out with the NPF.
Thank you for that response, Pam. And I see that Craig and also David would like to come in on this.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I think the drive of this policy and NPF4 is about providing more renewable energies and such like, and that's a very positive thing. I think it is disproportionately the weight of that is disproportionately felt by certain councils in the more rural areas. You know, such as ourselves in the Ayrshires and the Fraser and Galloway and the South Lanarkshire. From there, I think the key thing for us, and this ties back into a point that was discussed on earlier on about the plans and things that are missing from the plans. We have the UNESCO biosphere, the Galloway and South Ayrshire UNESCO biosphere, and it's not mentioned at all in NPF4. And that's a really important thing for us for tourism and from an ecological point of view as well, to support that. And how that ties into the provision of wind farms and renewable energy in those areas, because there's a lot of overlap, is a real challenge. And that's something that we'd like to see the most significance on in the document. In terms of how it impacts on the resources for ourselves, when we get a wind farm application in, and if they're of the larger size are dealt with by the Energy Consent Unit, so we're a consultee on that process, that's a huge amount of resource for ourselves. And if we object to that, it then goes to public inquiry, which can take one of our officers out of the process for a considerable number of weeks in terms of dealing with that public inquiry. And it usually comes down to the landscape impact, the impact on local properties in the areas of the wind farm. The overarching element, yes, we're keen to see renewable energies, but the net zero drive and the saving the planet is a huge factor for everybody, and everybody believes in it as an important thing. But I'm not sure that it's necessarily shared across the burden on that, it's shared across the entire country from there. I think that's what I'd like to say in that. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Craig. And thank you for bringing in the UNESCO biospheres. I mean, that's really important to make a note of that. David and then Ian. And actually, before you go, David, I just want to note that we are going to run over time a little bit, and I'm going to let it go to 11:15 and try to stop us at that point. Clearly, we've got a lot to discuss here. So, David.
Thank you, Convener, and absolutely respect the timings. I suppose just to pick up on Craig's last point, which I think ties in very nicely with what Jane mentioned earlier, and that's the sort of the heavy lifting that many of the rural authorities have to do in order to, I'm going to say, supply renewable energy to the country. And I think there's equally a role in urban areas like my own to try and decarbonise the heat that we use, decarbonise the energy that we use. So I suppose going back to Stephen's earlier point about the low carbon heat guidance, which has been worked on for some time, and the lack of perhaps reference to that in National Planning Framework 4, I think that can have a huge impact on trying to take some of the carbon out of the energy that we use, particularly within our urban areas. We are fortunate to have three heat networks across the city, one run by the council, but one run by the NHS and another by the university. But we need the sort of the support, and MPF4 could form part of that to really scale those up. And I think there's a real opportunity there. I think the other point that I just wanted to highlight was around hydrogen. Hydrogen is mentioned several times throughout the document, and it's very welcome to see that. And I think it's going to be an important factor in our decarbonisation journey, not just green hydrogen, but also other forms of less clean hydrogen as we move to net zero. But I think it's interesting that while there's, I think 22 references to hydrogen throughout the document, when you get to the green energy policy, there's only one reference to it, and that's in the preamble. There's nothing actually referenced in terms of the policies themselves, where there is lots of reference to wind, solar, carbon capture and storage and so forth. But that in and of itself puts the pressure on rural authorities to carry that burden, you know, and whereas hydrogen can be and is being developed in more urban areas. There's certainly opportunities to expand that further, as we are doing with BP and the hopeful connection to offshore renewables. So, yeah, I would just encourage a wider use of or a wider reference to hydrogen and to heat networks throughout the document. Thank you.
Thanks very much, David. It's helpful to get your specific scenarios in Aberdeen. I'm going to bring in Ian, and then I'm going to move on with a couple of closing questions.
Thank you. Just to highlight the role of MPF, and it only really covers development that comes under the Planning Acts, and that's maybe why there's such a focus on onshore wind, but it does actually miss out on things like offshore wind, tidal and wave power. And again, highlights the point that we were making earlier, and they need to tie up with other plans and strategies, for example, a National Marine Plan, and make sure that these things are actually knitted together. Thanks.
Thank you for that. And thanks for being so succinct with that response. I'm going to just come in with another question. It's around land assembly. So witnesses, including Planning Democracy and the Scottish Land Commission, have argued that MPF4 goals can only be delivered if the public sector takes a far more proactive role in land assembly and development. Do you agree with this? And if so, what needs to change for this to happen? And I'm not quite sure who to direct that to. Maybe just somebody put an R in the chat if you've got a response on that, and I'll take a couple of responses. Thanks. Okay, Pam, thank you. You're not...
That's really throughout.
Sorry, if you start again, you weren't on yet. Yep.
I think we've touched on this throughout our discussion this morning, particularly when we've talked about brownfield sites or sites within town centres as some focus of our discussion. And that's where, in areas of low land value, basically where it's not commercially viable to bring forward a site, or where the risks are too high to a commercial, you know, to a business, then greater scale come in to drive forward those sites. And whether that is assembling land, whether that's giving confidence to a developer to pick up a site that has the infrastructure already there, that's decontaminated, or whatever the issues are with that site. Sometimes that could be about the public sector doing the physical works. Sometimes that might be about just financially assisting the private sector to go in and do those works. So I think there are different ways of achieving it. But what I think has come out this morning and in other sessions that you've had is that there needs to be, to get that scale of ambition to bring forward at large brownfield redevelopment and the repurposing of sites, we will need public funding.
Thank you very much for that. And I just also note that Craig said earlier, with that kind of power, you need a plan and then you need time and resources. I'm going to also move on just with a kind of closing question to see if there's any other specific improvements you think that could be made to the draft that have not already been highlighted in this session or in your written submissions. I know we've covered a lot, but just in case there's something that you really want to tell us today. And you can put an R in the chat for that. And I'm going to bring in Jane.
Thanks, Convener. It was just to kind of go back to the renewables, but also just as a concept that's missing throughout a lot of the policy. Arguably, this is with my day job hat on, and that would be cross-boundary issues. So when you're talking about large-scale wind farms, there's going to be some cross-boundary issues there. Anything that's got a network in it will have most likely cross-boundary issues there. This is a position for RSSEs, and I just think there needs to be a little bit more of that in there, because things don't necessarily always happen within a local authority bounded area.
Thank you very much for that. That's a pretty crucial point. Is there okay, so I see Pam would like to come in, Ian, and then Craig.
Two very brief points. The first one that we haven't touched on today is HOPS considers that there's a missing part to the MPF draft which should set out the economic and population characteristics to 2045 so that the strategy can be seen in its wider and fuller context. And the second point relates to perhaps a more technical aspect, but how it's actually going to work, and that's the transitional arrangements. And one of the other consultations ongoing just now is about the local development plan regulations. But certainly we want to be very clear about how those transitional arrangements will work to take us forward to the new style of local development plans, sort of development plans with MPF and local development plans. So I think that there is a bit of concern in local authorities about what is proposed as those transitional arrangements. And we need to have certainty about how that's going to move forward.
Thank you, Pam. And Ian?
Hi, thank you. Yes, I'm supposed to highlight policy 31 and rural places. We haven't really spent a lot of time discussing rural places and, for example, brownfield sites and urban development. One of the things that Orkney and the Western Isles ourselves are particularly concerned about is the proposal to resettle previously uninhabited areas. And I think the concerns of that is these, you know, uninhabited islands or remoter areas that we have very limited or no access to transport or schools or healthcare facilities, waste collection, you know, digital connectivity. Probably be in conflict or potential to be in conflict with policy 32 on natural places. And also potential conflict in terms of protecting good quality land and how we conflict with 20-minute neighbourhoods and sustainable development when a lot of our good quality land is close to existing settlements. Also, just to pick up on the fact that when we were talking about housing, things like developer contributions and 25% of development given over to affordable houses. In places like Shetland, the only volume house builder is Zing Association, and therefore they are delivering on affordable houses by default. So we just have to remember that there's not a one-size-fits-all approach to housing and housing types and tenures and things like that. When we're looking at the future of development in rural places. And thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Ian. That's very helpful. And Craig?
Good points from me. We haven't touched at all on national developments this morning. And there's no, in the MPF 3, we had the Prestwick Airport and the Spaceport round about it as a national development, and it's disappeared from MPF 4. And we don't know why. And it's an important thing. We've got the spaceport coming through, and it's not there. The other element is, I was once just to mention, We have, in terms of the document, it makes reference to the Glasgow City deal and how important it is, and then talks about the Ayrshire growth deal as if it's a secondary element serving the Glasgow area. Obviously, we stand on our own 2 feet and we're important in that regard. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much for making those two important points. Absolutely take that on board. Is there anybody else before I close? Okay, so I just want to say thank you so much. I've had a lot of questions in my mind. We've been taking a lot of evidence, and I feel like this session with all of you this morning has really helped actually fill in some gaps. And I'm sure that my colleagues have, found it a very useful session too. So with that, I'm going to say thank you, and we are going to move into private.